ever seen it. Yeah.
All right. Good morning, everybody. We are ready to get started. We're going to pick up this study on suicide with lesson three. The case against the suicide, resolving the paradox. So let's get started with an opening prayer, and then we will jump right into our study, okay? Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right, hang on a second.
Gotta change some batteries.
A little.
You don't want your faith to go up and down. You want to have it quietly inside of you. what she's feeling. I might be caught up in the exhilaration, the emotional, I can't wait, of sin. And that's not where my faith should be at all. It doesn't mean I'm not a believer in that still. But the pull of sin might be leading me to this emotional excitement for something that I actually know is very wrong. So emotions and faith are not always the same thing. What about intellect or cognitive thinking and faith? Give me an example of how those two aren't the same. And this one should be pretty easy. Mark?
I mean, you guys can pick out any miracle, like this Jesus walked on water, it doesn't make sense, but it happened.
Yeah, you can take any miracle that Jesus did, and according to our human reason, we think, no, not possible. But we believe it anyway. In fact, I would submit, I say this in Bible discovery class, when we're going through the characteristics of God, there's not a single characteristic God has that I get. If I'm going to believe it, if I can understand it, I'm not going to believe a single thing about God. Because none of it makes sense, including his love for me. Thankfully. Right? Okay. How many, raise your hand if you had your child baptized when they were a baby. Okay? Describe the cognitive thinking capability of your little baby. So when did your baby finally have faith? What age? When she or he became 7, 8, 10, what? Or did you believe that by God's grace your baby could believe even at that young age? Faith isn't equated with intellectual reasoning ability, and it's not equated with emotion. They're not the same thing. Here's another one. I go visit a shut-in. What do you think I hear from shut-ins quite often?
Loneliness.
Exactly, complaining. They're not a lot different than me, of course. But with their pastor, they tell me everything that's on their heart and mind that's bad in their life. Almost always, by the end of the conversation, almost invariably, what are they saying? What are they adding? But I know God's taking care of me. But I'm so grateful for what I have in Jesus. They're thinking about their life situation, and their emotions isn't always the same thing as their faith. Okay. All right, so what problems are caused if one believes faith is equated with those things? Why?
Your faith depends on you.
Yeah, and what do I know about my thinking? The biggest trouble I've ever been in my life has been caused by following my own stupid thinking. Great. I started the Bible discovery class a couple of weeks ago, and I said, our thinking is what gets us in trouble. I said, every time, why would I rely on my thinking? The worst things I've experienced in my life are when I follow my own thinking. And one of the guys goes, that's why I'm here. I said, stay in thinking. Got me in trouble all the time. I'm in trouble again. That's why I'm here. What about your emotions? How reliable are they?
It depends on the time.
What's that?
I say it depends on the time.
Yeah. My emotions are going to go all over the place. They're not reliable. There's some real problems if our faith is equated with those things when it comes to suicide. What do I mean by that? If I think that faith has to be equated with rational thinking and my emotions being God-pleasing and proper, what am I going to conclude?
If you're thinking about suicide, God wants to make you think that.
Pardon me?
If you're contemplating and thinking about suicide, if you believe in faith, you're thinking, God must have made me think this.
Well, you know, I've never thought about that. But, you know, the lame excuse that's so prevalent in our culture, God gave me desires, then I must be able to act on them when I'm thinking of sinful desires. If I have a desire, it's in my heart, God must have put it there, so I'm going to act on it, and he's fine with it. I guess I never thought about it. Same, you could follow that logic with suicide and be really messed up, right? I think there's no reason to live so that, you know, if I have a thought and God lives in me, that thought must be from God, so it's okay. That would be bad. If your emotions and your rational thinking are equated with faith, to say that the person who committed suicide
didn't have faith.
Didn't have faith because they weren't thinking the right way. They must not have been feeling the right way. But faith isn't equated with our thinking or our emotions necessarily. There's other problems. I think we identified a few of those. Number three, Acts chapter 16, verse 31. Who'd like to read that from the screen nice and loudly? Remember, we're being videotaped and you need to be audible. Mark.
Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household.
So, what's the object of our faith?
Jesus.
It's Jesus. There's a particular message. Who can read John 3:16? Yeah, Linda.
For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life.
All right. So a couple of things we learned here. The object of my faith is Jesus. It's the gospel. It's not how I feel, and it's not whether I'm always thinking the way I should think as a Christian. And thankfully, that's true because I don't always feel or think the right way. Does that make sense so far? Okay, let's go on. Christian faith is not generated by an exercise of the will. It is not initiated by some human activity. It is the Holy Spirit who enables us to trust in Christ and his work of redeeming sinners. Coming to faith and remaining in such faith is brought about not by one's ability or strength, but entirely by the working of the Holy Spirit who grants faith through the word of the gospel. We're going to see that that's true. We take a look at the screen here. Who would like to read 1 Corinthians 2, verse 14, and also a little later in that letter, chapter 12, verse 3?
The man without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them, because they are spiritually discerned. Therefore, I tell you that no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit.
Okay, so tell me what Paul is saying in the first part. This part right here. If I don't have the Holy Spirit, how do I look at what God reveals to me in his word?
Nonsense.
First thing is, I don't accept it. The natural sinful heart, apart from the word of the Holy Spirit, doesn't accept what the Holy Spirit reveals in the word of God. Why not? Because it's foolishness. The other day in Bible Discovery class, I'm going through this interview Bono, lead singer of U2, rock band, is having with his interviewer, and the interviewer is asking him about his religious beliefs. And so Bono says, I believe karma is true. I believe that what you do comes back to you. I think it's a general rule that if you do bad stuff's going to happen. If you do good stuff, it's more likely good stuff is going to happen to you. But when it comes to my faith in God, I believe that God interrupted my karma. He said, I've done a lot of bad things, and I should get punishment from God. But his love intercepted what I should be getting for what I've done. I believe in God's grace. I'm holding up for the fact that although I don't deserve anything good from God, he's given me the opposite of what I deserve in his love for me in Jesus Christ. Whoa! The guy said, I'd like to believe that, but it sounds like lunacy to me.
It sounds like lunacy.
The man without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, and they're foolishness to them. He can't understand them. I don't get it. Because they are So faith is something the Holy Spirit works in me and continues to keep alive in my heart. That's important when it comes to suicide too, so that we can trust God in his mercy. He not only gives us faith, but keeps it in, us in the faith even when our thinking and our emotions are in the wrong place. Okay, moving on. Faith does not save on account of its nature or its attributes. It does not save because it is particularly trusting, because it is exceptionally uncompromising, or because faith is so strong or secure. Faith saves solely because of what it possesses. Faith saves because of the object of faith, not because of the quality of faith, in other words. That object being Christ and his forgiveness. Can you give some examples of how people talk about faith and make it sound like the quality of one's faith makes it a saving faith? You complete the sentence. I know Grandma is in heaven because... What's that? Yeah, Grandma was just the most devout believer I have ever known. That woman read her Bible every year. She went to church every Sunday. She was so nice to other people. Served on the church committees, you know, her whole life. Like, Grandma's strength of faith is why I'm certain she's in heaven. You guys got that, right? Not the strength of faith, but what your faith is in. How about six on that page? Okay, we're looking on to Romans 3, verse 28. Paul says there, we maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from observing the law. So Paul says we are justified or declared not guilty by faith. Identify what Paul says faith is not in this verse. What is it? Mark. Okay, faith is not observing the law. Faith isn't me doing what God tells me to do. Believe. And so I say, okay, I'm going to decide to believe. God calls us to faith, but he, in calling us to faith, gives us his spirit so that we can believe. So what are some words or terms that we should probably avoid when it comes to describing faith, is they make it look like faith is a human word. Linda.
Accepting Christ.
Yeah, this idea that I accepted him. If I'm a homeless guy, and I am hungry, and somebody is walking away from a restaurant with a $50 meal and sees me sitting there homeless and hungry and gives me the meal, do I tell my homeless buddies later in the day, I was smart enough to accept the free meal today? Or what his wording rather be, somebody gave you a free meal. Do you see the slight difference between the two? Yeah.
I was thinking about that when you were talking about an earlier slide there about our feelings and all of that. So if I accepted based on my good judgment, I could really doubt that the next day, too. I mean, because I've talked to people who believe in that theology, and they think that if you accepted Christ and then you fall away, it's because you never really did accept him. That is not really good theology.
I met a woman who described her experience growing up this way. She said when I was about 8 years old, I'd gone to church with some friends. I got down on my knees at my bedside and I said to Jesus, as she was told to do in her church, you give your heart to Jesus, you accept him, you give yourself away, surrender yourself to him, and that's faith. So she does that, and it's a couple weeks later that she's thinking to herself, nothing's changed. I still sin as much as I used to. So what's her next move? I better do that over again. So she does it over again. And that's her childhood. Giving her life to Jesus, saying, I am yours, I believe. This is me saying, I am committed this time, Jesus. And then being weighed down by her sins to the point that that it's a gift from God. Because I'm telling you right now, there's a big part of me that says, no. You either decide to believe it or you don't. It's that simple. Jill?
Well, when people say they're on fire for the Lord, they're usually equating their strength of faith, you know, for, you know, being proof of their faith. And I heard a Lutheran pastor say, being on fire for the Lord is actually living in repentance every day and looking at our sin and recognizing now that we deserve help for it.
Yeah. A woman I've gotten to know and I visit in the hospice center in Eaton Rapids. I visited her maybe, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 times now. About 3 visits ago, she says to me, what do you think about this? She said, you know, I kind of wonder if spiritual maturity isn't reaching a deeper level of understanding just how hopeless and helpless we really are. How unable we are to do anything for ourselves apart from God's grace. Agree or disagree?
Agree.
She's totally right. I think when I grow in spiritual maturity, I think less of how great I'm doing as a Christian. I think I realize more and more how much of a miserable failure I really am apart from God and grace.
Going back to baptism, I believe that is the gift of the Holy Spirit to that child or that adult. What other ways does the Holy Spirit enter our lives other than baptism?
Answer to that question? Lord's Supper.
Hey.
Answer to the question is also just God's word. The gospel that's true. It's always the gospel, right? It's always the good news about Jesus, either communicated through the sacraments or through the preached, written, heard word. Great story. There's this hardened criminal gang member in L.A. who ends up in prison. And some guy tells him to read John 3:16. He's never opened the Bible, so he opens it up and reads 1 John 3:16. Which happens to have essentially the message, same message as John 3:16. And the power of the gospel in that verse makes him a believer in Jesus. All right, face add-ons. We got you on? We ready to do that? Okay, much of the stigma associated with suicide among Christians has to do with what we can call faith add-ons. People have preconceived ideas about how true faith will perform in a given situation. Popular opinion would have us believe we can feel good about our faith or someone else's faith as long as certain standards are maintained and other Christians are able to pick up on them. For example, we choose good over evil, we understand God's grace and are able to verbalize our appreciation for it. We demonstrate enthusiasm for serving in our various locations. We're always optimistic concerning the future. Faith plus obedience. This is the first faith add-on we're going to be careful of. Can a Christian choose what he knows to be wicked? The first add-on has to do with obedience. It's assumed that Christians will just not do certain things. Christians will never murder, commit adultery, steal, or be seduced into idolatrous practices. Genuine Christians, moreover, do not commit suicide. A true believer loves God's commandments, and makes choices in life in conformity to his commandments. However, faith consists not of trust plus Christian works or avoidance of particular sins. Christian faith is trust in the Savior who secured forgiveness and salvation for us on the cross. Nothing more, nothing less. So the question is, why would someone choose what's obviously wicked then? If you're a Christian, why would you choose something that clearly is wicked?
Because we're sinful.
Because as a Christian, you're sinful.
Sometimes,
right. Because we're sinful? Let's see if the Apostle Paul agrees with that. Who would like to read Nice and Lovely, Romans 7, 18 through 23?
I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For what I do is not the good I want to do, no, the evil I do not want to do. This I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members.
So if you want to say that the Christian who committed suicide must be in hell because they didn't obey God to respect their own life and let God decide when it was time for them to kill themselves, what do you have to say about the Apostle Paul? He must be where? In hell. Because he admits, yeah, I don't do what I'm supposed to do. I disobey God all the time. And that must mean you also are bound for where? For hell. Because you as a Christian disobey God in thought, word, and deed, as we confess every Sunday, every day. So, we don't equate obedience with faith. Is that understandable? How about faith plus reason? Can a Christian believe as he should if he cannot reason as he should? Another add-on to Christian faith relates to the ability to reason in a proper sense. It is asserted that Christians do not draw certain conclusions. A true believer, for example, will not determine God is against me, he hates me, I'd be better off dead. While it is true that reason serves as a guide to a Christian's behavior and thoughts, it is not true that Christian faith depends on reason. In many cases, faith must oppose reason, as when reason tells one that God's word makes no sense or that listening to God's word will not serve one's best interest. Faith is not the same thing as one's ability to reason properly. By the grace of God, a sick mind does not represent a sick faith. 8. What comfort and caution comes with that last underlying statement? What comfort comes with that to start with? Dan?
God's always in control.
God's always in control. Can you give me an example of sick thinking that can exist in the mind of a Christian?
Addiction.
Addiction. I need this. What it is, maybe even something sinful, let alone something morally neutral. A person who is mentally ill and says, I feel God hates me, I feel my life is worth nothing, I feel like life isn't worth living. Sick thinking, but it doesn't mean their faith is sick. What about Alzheimer's? Person who's lost the ability to even recognize relatives. Does that mean they don't have faith anymore when their mind is that gone? Or is faith completely, again, different from and separate from human intellect? I know it's interesting that the Bible describes faith much more often as a spiritual rebirth, something that happens in my very heart and soul versus something that takes place intellectually.
I was going to say that thinking is our brain, and our love of God is not in our brain, it's in our heart.
What caution comes with that last statement? A sick mind does not represent a sick faith.
People might just use that as an excuse to sin, say, oh, you know, I think this way, and other people, I don't believe still.
And access to that. Yeah, I might be thinking in a very sick, wrong way. And just to say, well, that doesn't mean I don't believe anymore. That's just such a lame cop-out joke.
We're still commanded to be sober-minded, too, to think of things that are pure and lovely and true.
Yeah, so it doesn't mean that I should just let my thinking be transformed by the world, but I should mold my thinking from God's word.
Christ tells us he will never leave us.
Yeah, that's... Be careful about judging that because somebody's thinking is sick, their faith must be sick too. How about 9? Consider the middle statement. That statement is, it is not true that Christian faith depends on reason. Can you give some examples of doctrines you believe, even though they fly in the face of human reason?
Virgin birth.
Virgin birth of Jesus. The Trinity. Oh, by the way.
Resurrection.
Yikes. I can't even get past who is God. Three persons, one God, not three. Yikes. I'm sitting down, I open up my lunch pail.
As usual, homemade bread. The kids had butter bread, and I was stuck with mom's homemade bread. Again, don't trust your own thinking, right? I can't believe I despised my mom's homemade bread. But I remember thinking to myself, I'm going to figure out eternity today. So as I'm eating my sandwich, I'm thinking to myself, okay, I can go back to when Jesus died on the cross 2,000 years ago, I get that. I can go back all the way to creation, I get that. And then before that, God was in existence. And then after a while, I was like, oh, this is not working. So I can't understand eternity. What else can I not understand?
Resurrection?
Anybody ever see anybody dead come back to life again? I mean, really dead. Not just like close to clinically dead, but they weren't really dead. Okay, yeah, I mean, every single doctrine, I believe, it is a matter of faith. It all takes faith to believe it. Even the doctrine that the Bible is actually God's word, have you thought of that? That takes faith.
I think forgiveness is really, really, His forgiveness is really hard for me to understand. Our forgiveness for mine is so limited that it's, I just can't imagine wanting to forgive somebody over and over again for that person's whole life.
Yeah.
And then when He was on the cross and He said, forgive these people for they don't know what they're doing. I mean, He wanted to forgive people who weren't even sorry. I just can't comprehend that.
Yeah. Pastor Colbert said something in a Bible class one time on forgiveness that he did for our elders. That struck me, I never thought about it. The difference between God's forgiveness and mine is after I forgive somebody, my relationship with them may nevertheless be changed forever. I'm going to look at that person differently for the rest of my life. When God forgives me, He sees me the same way He did before my sin. And I just don't get that. I don't see how that's possible. And because my faith is weak when it comes to that, I often find myself doing really stupid things. Like after I've really done something awful, and I know I'm forgiven, I want to now prove to God, you know what, I'm different from now on. Because I'm hoping that's going to lead Him to see me differently when I don't have to do that. It's wasted effort. Okay. Let's go on to faith plus self-esteem. Can a Christian believe in Christ if he cannot believe in himself? Another add-on to Christian faith is noted when we observe the overemphasis many place on self-esteem. People believe that an unhealthy regard for oneself is indicative of an unhealthy faith, or that unless I can clearly see and deeply feel what God says about me, my faith is not what it should be. True faith, however, is simply trust in Christ. Its object is not our abilities or our self-image, but strictly our Savior and His work of redeeming sinners. So, first question, in what ways do you struggle to fully grasp or feel God's truth, both about your identity as a sinner and your identity as a child of God? Let's start with, how do you struggle to accept what God says about you when it comes to your identity as a sinner? Yeah.
He says I'm not. He says I've exchanged your sin for my righteousness. And through God's eyes, when He looks at me, He sees Jesus, and that is mind-boggling.
Yeah, only faith can grasp that too, right? Do you struggle with accepting your identity?
wrong.
Lie. The sinful heart is deceitful above all things beyond cure. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector, or my boss, or my dad, or my spouse, or my
sister.
You say, I am rich and I have acquired wealth and do not need a thing, but you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I think that just because my life's going pretty well right now, everything's kind of cruising along, that I'm not as deeply needy as I am in my sin. Here's the truth about how God looks at you. How great is the love of the Father has lavished on us, and that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. I want to ask you, why does he include that statement afterwards? Why does he feel that he has to add it? Oh, and by the way, I'm not kidding. This is the truth. This is who you really are. Why does he have to say that? Exactly. The reason the world does not know us is that the world did not know him. You're not going to walk into a crowd of people, and if they know you're a Christian, they're not going to all, like it's the Red Sea, and you're a Christian, I recognize your high standing in God's eyes for Christ. It's not going to happen. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. We are children of God, and the best is yet to come when we stand before him and see him face to face. Faith plus optimism. Last section. Anything on this last section? Okay, can a Christian despair? I think this is a really important one when we're talking about a Christian and suicide. A final add-on to faith is optimism, which we could define as having a sound hope in one's future. Faith, however, is not the same thing as maintaining a positive view of life. We can have faith in Christ, and at the same time, have no confidence that we will regain our once comfortable, tranquil life. Having become emotionally despondent or psychologically desperate, a Christian may nevertheless trust in Christ for mercy and rescue from sin. Christians, on occasion, do despair. In a vast majority of cases, however, the individual who has become suicidal is despairing not of God's grace, but of his life. He doesn't lack faith in the gospel. He lacks hope in this life. He believes his time on earth will never improve. On this side of heaven, God will not help him overcome his troubles. The loss of hope does not always indicate a loss of faith. And we're going to see that in the following people. Job, Elijah, and Moses. And by the way, let's keep in mind that the Old Testament Jews, by the time of Jesus, were calling the scriptures Moses and the prophets, and the greatest prophet besides Moses was Elijah. And everybody looks up to Job for his faith, right? Let's see how these three pillars of faith sometimes fell. You guys know Job's circumstances. You can tell me, thumbnail sketch, what did Job endure? Lost everything. He lost his family. He lost his health. He lost his
livestock,
his wealth, his money.
His reputation.
His reputation. People started saying, well, Job must have done something really bad that God's treated like this. Lost his friends. This is how he felt. Who'd like to read Job 6 and 7, the selected verses there, nice and loudly? Linda. walks back out for the next 3 years. Elijah hangs out at the Brook Kidron doing nothing. Fulfilling ministry. Remember, he gets fed by ravens and he drinks from the brook until it dries up. Eventually, he ends up on Mount Carmel. And remember that show off between the false prophets and Elijah? And Elijah, you know, prays for God to consume the altar and the sacrifice. And that happens. And everybody says, the Lord, he is God. And it is time for spiritual restoration. And Elijah finally has some joy that his ministry is not a waste of time until he has to run for his life. And as he's sitting out under a broom tree in the desert, here's what happens. Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba and Judah, he left his servant there while he himself went a day's journey into the desert. He came to a broom tree, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. I have had enough. He said, take my life. I am no better than my ancestors. In other words, I give up. Done. Can you imagine? Can you understand why he felt that? God hardly gave him a chance to do anything, and when he finally did something that he thought was successful, it just seemed like it was all for nothing. How about Moses? This is Moses responding to the rebelliousness of the Israelites. Who'd like to read that nice, lovely, clearly? Todd's got it.
He asked the Lord, why have you brought this trouble on your servant? What have I done to displease you, that you put the burden of all these people on me? Did I conceive all these people? Did I give them birth? Why do you tell me to carry them in my arms as a nurse carries an infant to the land you promised an oath to their forefathers? Where can I get meat for all these people? They keep wailing to me. Give us meat to eat. I cannot carry all these people by myself. The burden is too heavy for me. If this is how you're going to treat me, put me to death right now if I have found favor in your eyes, and do not let me face my own ruin.
So, can you tell me how Moses was having some stinky thinking? What was he really saying here? What did he mistakenly think, Pam?
I don't want this much responsibility, and you can't do this to me.
Yep. Of course, the thing he didn't understand is that he was saying, this burden is on me, I can't take it. When in reality, what? It was God's responsibility. You know, Moses couldn't provide meat for the people. God could. He could make quail fly in the camp so they had meat. He could make manna fall from heaven. But I think we understand when we feel just overwhelmed by everything in our lives and sometimes by our responsibilities. So, Elijah and Moses were really out. And yet on the Mount of Transfiguration, he was standing there with Jesus. Moses and Elijah. So thankfully, God didn't look down on them and say, your thinking stinks. Done with you. Where's your trust in me? You can't see the big picture. His grace sustained them at the end of heaven. And you know, I'm kind of grateful Job's words are recorded, because it reminds us that these pillars of faith were as weak as I am. And by God's grace, this same Job could also say, I know my Redeemer cares too. So what comfort do we have even in the pit of despair? When we are in that place where we see no light, no hope, let's take a look for our closing at these verses. Would you like to read Psalm 34, verse 18? Yeah, well.
The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit.
What do you like about that verse?
He's talking about me.
About me. Where's God when I'm at that point where I've almost given up hope entirely?
He's right there.
He's still there. But in your great mercy, you did not put an end to them or abandon them, for you are a gracious and merciful God. Who do you think that Nehemiah is talking about? Don't think
kind of God we have, he has great mercy so that he doesn't just say, I'm done with you, or put an end to us when we get into these cycles of hopelessness and despair or even disobedience for each generation of those who will have. So, one big takeaway from this lesson today.
You are lost.
Yeah.
Faith has no add-ons.
Anybody else got another takeaway thought as you leave? Cameron? Emotion and intellect do not equal faith. That sounds so simple, but once you just need to go back to that again and again, how I feel isn't the truth. What I think isn't the truth if God tells me otherwise.
Doug, I have a question. Growing up in the Wells Lutheran Church, this is not the message that I heard. When did it change?
Explain what you're saying.
Suicide was looked at as the ultimate sin. The pastor at the church that I went to grew up in wouldn't even do any kind of funeral, wouldn't have anything to do with anybody that committed suicide.
And I have the same experience.
I think that's where a lot of us probably got our feelings about suicide and about, you know, not the forgiveness. It's not our own thing.
And I think it's really sad for the people who have gone through that experience 50 years ago because they didn't have the feelings that we're getting now.
They didn't get the support of the church 50 years ago. No.
Okay, Tracy, follow up on that?
In the movie Martin Luther buried in the cemetery of what he committed suicide. So he himself said, this boy is sick in the head, not.
I'm just saying, that's what I was taught when I grew up in the Wells Church.
Me too.
Pastor Tolbert talked a little bit about this in the first section of this. About
I guess
how
I should come every week, is that right?
Or go on and watch the video from the first week because they're online. But he talked a little bit about how there was a notion kind of in the early church of seeking martyrdom and going out and saying, well, I'm going to be a martyr. Being a martyr was a good, it's so good that people started trying to be a martyr. And then was it Augustinian, possibly, who went and said, this is not such a great thing. And so then it was trying to combat this idea of going out and trying to be a martyr. Rather than just, if this happens, this is what I accept. And so there was kind of a pushback in the larger church over people who are trying to be martyrs and trying to be killed for faith and saying, okay, this is not such a good thing. And so then that went to the extreme that way. And so it's kind of probably depends on the specific church you grew up in and where that landed on the spectrum.
Chris, in my catechism class, I remember Pastor saying that you have never had a chance to ask for forgiveness after killing yourself. And that's how you explained it. That's being
cast.
As others have put it,
how many people die with sins they have done?
Yes.
I mean,
that was
right down the road. You just got to stay quiet or something. And before you've had a chance to read that, your life is different. So, is that any different?
Yeah, I think that, by the way, I heard that too, Chris.
I'm not defending what I'm saying.
No, I get you. You don't want to commit suicide because you don't give yourself the opportunity to repent, which is a 95 theses misunderstanding of what repentance is. Repentance, Luther said in 95 theses, is a way of life. And it's not just a sporadic act now and then, so that I say, okay, looking back over the last day, I repent of that, so I trust in Jesus now, that's good. Your whole life is a life of repentance. Repentance is tied up with your faith itself.
led too easily to us just sometimes automatically saying, well, that person, their sin of suicide, which is all sin, was not so much a sin of weakness, but a sign of defiance of God and of repentance.
I guess the question is, when did our synod decide to go this more comforting and biblical way of looking at suicide?
Tell you to do well, or did the church just tell you that's a sin? Because it is a sin.